I honestly sit here and say he's probably one of the best riders I've worked with. They can't change too much for 2024, but for 2025, I do believe the planning on building a complete new motorcycle. And even going back to the early 90s, I'd assisted like Joey Dunlop, Brian Reid, and won TTs with them. So I've got a wealth of TT experience. And you could literally see Josh's face go like that. And he says, there's no way. Am I pointing my bike at a wall, going up a gear and going full throttle? He came and sat next to me and I opened my clipboard and I'm like, right, Nari, what's the problem? And he just got my clipboard and shut it. And he says, there's no problem. And I says, well, what's up? And his words were, he says, Nari's not been paid.
2023 was a roller coaster season as crew chief at FHO Racing for Josh Brookes. But he's more than ready for the challenge of 2024 with the same team and the same rider. Early season successes for Josh didn't translate into the championship challenge that neither crew chief or rider had hoped for. While on the road racing front, a curtailed Northwest 200 preceded a return to the Isle of Man TT races, and then rounding out the season as Josh made his debut out in Macau with Mark by his side. That's Mark Woodage. This is Off Track, the motorcycle racing podcast. Welcome to Off Track, the motorcycle racing podcast. I'm your host, Dave Neal. Welcome to MJW Performance. Welcome, more importantly, Brains, Mark Woodage. Welcome Hello. Back, mate. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good, thanks. Really good.
A year since we did this.
About exactly a year, I think it was. It was definitely January 12 months ago, so yeah.
Yeah, and this is recording properly now. We tried it on the GoPros last time, and I was disappointed because you were going to be the first one in video, and it just didn't quite work because we didn't have this kit that we've got now.
Yeah, it just didn't happen, did it? I remember us filming it and setting it up, and we had a few batteries go flat and things like that, and... Yeah, it just never happened, did it?
That's not going to happen now.
The pod happened.
The audio's still there. If you want to go back and listen to that one, then you get an idea of what's happened in the last 12 months for Brains. But mate, has it been?
Yeah, it's been good, actually. It's been good to be in the UK. Obviously not travelling like what I were. I mean, don't get me wrong, I miss MotoGP, miss that paddock, miss my friends, the racing, the environment, but not the travel, you know. BSB's a great championship. They put on a really good show. I was quite surprised coming back how, you know, professional and ran it is, and the media exposure it gets. And I can't complain. It's been a good season, you know.
I know you when we spoke 12 months ago, you were just in that flux, weren't you, between finishing at MotoGP and then coming into BSB with FHO with Josh. How did the season go from your point of view with Josh? Because you hear things in the paddock that he's not the easiest to work with, but sometimes I think there's two sides to every story.
Yeah, obviously I'd heard, because I know a lot of people, so I'd heard quite a few stories about, you know, Josh can be difficult, etc. To be fair, I'd honestly sit here and say he's probably one of the best riders I've worked with, just because on his professionalism. And it isn't that he's difficult, it's just because he wants to win. So if Josh wants to sit and go through data for an hour, or you know, he wants to grind you down because he wants something, it's only because he wants to win. He's not being awkward in any shape or form. You know, I think we had a conversation at some point where we were testing somewhere, and he basically summed it up that he lives in Australia, and whenever he's in the UK, it's purely to do a job. So if he's got to be at a test venue and it's raining and hang around a garage, then for him it's fine because that's what he's here to do, you know. And that's his, that's just his dedication and everything. So working with Josh were good. Little bit nervous coming back to the British Championship. The team initially had built, you know, a great motorcycle. All our pre-season testing was done in wet conditions. So when we rocked up at Silverstone, it was the first time anything, you know, it was dry and I didn't know what to expect. And obviously Silverstone was a great opening round for us. We left Silverstone with I think Josh got man of the meeting. He were back on the podium after being sort of not being there for 2 years. He won a race, finished second, finished third. It was a dream start, really, and knowing that, I knew it was only going to go one direction from there, which pretty much it did do, to be fair. Not through anyone's effort or trying or anything, just the competitiveness of the sport, the BSB, and the actual bike we were working with isn't the easiest of motorcycles, you know. The start were good, and then we went from there, really.
It's it's never going to be easy with the BMW, is it?
No.
And I think anybody who's ever run one has found that.
Yeah, it's proven worldwide as well. You know, the world team struggles. I mean, now obviously they've signed Top Rack and that, and they're expecting bigger things. And during testing, he is going well, but it's quite, to do a lap on the BMW on your own, you take quite different lines and stuff, and it's not so bad to do it. But then when you're in a race environment and you're trying to outbrake someone and you're trying to stop the thing, that's when it starts to tie itself in knots and it becomes difficult. So doing a fast lap and racing it is two different things. So it'd be interesting to see how he gets on. Definitely BMW, what they made last year, have learned on some of the things that they did was probably wrong. So they've brought all new material to Jerez and Portugal now, which the official team's testing. That'll eventually filter down into the FHO team because they are a factory-backed team. Obviously, the actual team will take all the material and build a BSB spec bike, which we believe will be probably better than last year's bike. There are some rule changes at the minute, which may or may not hurt the BMW a bit. It's a bit indecisive on what we do, because quite a bit of that is out of the team's hands, you see, because BMW, being the factory team, they spec our engines and they seal them and build them. We're fortunate enough that one of the engine builders in our team, Andy, has got rights from Germany to pull them a bit and do his own refreshing and stuff. But basically, that's all we can do. They actually spec the engines themselves. So we're waiting on that. But I think there should be some improvement this year. We've also got a year of knowledge under our belt. Josh will obviously be as determined as ever, you know. Moving forward, hopefully the bike will be better. And I think moving even further forward, the BMW is only going to get better, you know, because I think with homologation, they can't change too much for 2024, but for 2025, I do believe they're planning on building a complete new motorcycle. And we know what its faults are, and you can't fix that just with just normal conventional stuff, you know. It needs a major change. So hopefully that can happen.
When we were at the start of last season, you pulled me to one side, because when I did our little chat with Whit at the start of the season, I forgot to mention Josh, didn't I?
Yeah, that's
Hickey.
Right.
Yeah, you've only just forgiven me. That's why it's right. Taken a year to get back to do this. He's only just forgiven me.
No, I do remember watching your podcast and you were talking about British Championship favourites and winners.
Yeah.
And Josh never even got a mention. And then obviously we rocked up at the first three rounds and won races and podiums and was at Donington, we were still leading the championship, you know, three rounds in. And I get why people had probably wrote him off, because he hadn't really done anything for 2 years.
Well, in our defence a little bit, it wasn't so much writing him off. It just wasn't having him as a front runner.
Yeah,
you know he's going to be top 10 and he's going to be pushing for top 5 regardless of what he rides. But he just didn't, we just missed him completely.
Yeah, and I think as an outsider coming in, I probably get why people sort of said that. But then actually seeing his work ethic and his dedication and how he is off the bike, I think it doesn't matter what manufactured bike you put under him. As long as it's right, he'll definitely win races.
Well, look what he did on the Tag Yamaha.
Yeah,
finished second in the championship by a handful of points.
You know, and he was the only person this year to win races on a BMW. Yeah. You know, and he did do a good job when it was right. He was one of the fastest riders on track. You know, and the difficult thing with the bike is it was keeping it right. The working window is so small on that bike that you steer out of it, and it was just a world of pain. But it is what it is, you know.
They say it's the same for all the BMW riders. Yeah. What's it been like for you to come back to BSB and work with BSB, with production machines, after so many years on the world scene with prototypes?
Yeah, I mean, a motorcycle's a motorcycle. There's not as much adjustment on this particular bike as what, you know, I've been used to. It'd be nice to have a little bit more that we can do to it, but some options aren't available. And it's been good, you know, the team's a good, solid team. They obviously prepare and build the bikes during the week. I'm only present at the weekend. And they deliver, you know, on a Thursday, a good bike. And then I'm just left just to sort of fine-tune it for Josh over a weekend, really. So I, actually coming back, they made it relatively quite simple for me, really, and made me feel welcome, and you know, so that side was really good, you know, and kept my head down all year, been quiet all year, just rocked up, done my job. There's definitely more potential from myself and us as a working team. It's just, you know, we just need some better material from BMW, you know, and I think we're still contenders, you know.
Yeah, that'll come in time, won't it?
Yeah,
any Rome one built in a day kind of thing. So you got to, the viewers and the listeners have really taken to having crew chiefs, mechanics, and not just the riders on the show. We had Chris Anderson on just after Christmas.
Okay, yeah, I did see that, yeah.
Thanks, mate. And it's gone down so well. Somebody described it as level two, which I thought was quite interesting. Sort of level one as a rider, level two as a crew chief, team manager, and that way. Over a weekend, what is your job? What do you do as a crew chief in British Superbikes over a weekend?
Kind of really as a crew chief, your main role is just to it's to brief your rider after a session. And then pretty much every decision is down to the crew chief. So then I've got to work close with my electronics guy, Andrea, to make sure that Josh has got the correct torque maps, the correct engine braking. You also work close with your suspension engineer, your mechanics, and your tyre man. And you're basically, your role is you're basically just the top of the pyramid, and you're just making sure everything is working. And, you know, obviously you've got the final say at the end of it on any decision, but it's just about getting the whole harmony working and everything, taking notes and, you know, just going through data and just obviously believing in your rider and whatever he asks for. You've just got to try and deliver, really, in whatever shape or form you can, you know. So that's it, really. I actually don't physically touch the bike. You know, I've got a couple of good mechanics that do all that. I don't have to worry about anything falling off it or anything like that. The guys are really good. It's just, at the end of the day, I've got to make a decision on a direction we go. And speaking with Josh, there's between the pair of us, that's where the decision comes from, you know. And sometimes you can put something forward, and some people might think that's probably not the right way to go. But you know, there's so many things you look at to come up with that decision, and that's basically what I try and do, really, is just keep control of that scenario. To be fair,
you've done both. And I suspect there's positives for doing both. But do you have a preference to work with more seasoned riders or the younger riders?
Yeah, again, I've worked with quite a lot of young riders, and mainly in the World Championship, because in Moto3, we were taking a lot of youngsters. So like Sasaki, for example, Ayuma, when he first joined the World Championship, he'd just turned 16 years old. And I think I spent 3 or 4 years with Ayuma. And you're basically teaching them a lot, as much as you're trying to get their information. Their information is quite limited, so you've got to be experienced enough to go through the data and make the call on behalf of them. Where working with an experienced rider like Josh, he understands everything on the bike, so he puts a lot forward, and you have to decide between the pair of us the direction. I'm not sort of one of them where I'd completely overrule the rider and go, nah, you're wrong, this is how we do it. It is always a team discussion, and we get to where we get to as a unit, you know. So sometimes it's easier with a more experienced rider, and then sometimes it's easier with a less experienced, because the decision is on you, so you don't take too much of the rider's input. You've just got to do what you feel's right, you know. So yeah, it's the same, really.
I thought it might be. There's pros for working with both. One thing I asked Spanner, and I'm going to ask you the same question, because I thought of it at the time, and it fascinated me. Have you ever told a rider that you've made a change when you haven't, from a placebo point of view?
Do you know what? I don't think I have, to be fair. I get it a lot. I get people in the team or people in teams in the past, like, just change it and don't tell him. But I think if a rider would find out, you lose that trust. And I believe a rider should know everything, whether he agrees or not. And then it's up to me to convince him, we're doing this session. just please go out and try it. I think they should know, you know, on the grounds of their safety more than anything.
Yeah.
Because if I change something and don't tell them and they're pushing at the level they have pushed before.
Of telling them you've changed something but you haven't. The opposite way around.
Yeah, again, I don't think I've done it. I've done in the past where I've made a change for their confidence. So they felt they needed something. So I've maybe gone half a turn of preload or something, which personally I think is probably unfeelable, but convince them that
even to the most experienced rider,
you know, we've made a change, and then they've gone out and for whatever reason they've found it in themselves and gone, yeah, that was so much better, knowing that it's probably not that much better, but it's about them believing that you've done something, so they take it onto the track.
Yeah.
So I would always change something, and down to the extreme as being as minute as that, because it's a confidence thing for them, and then that's what you've got to. They have to believe and trust in you, you know, which, yeah, difficult believing in me, innit? But, you know.
Killer, you'll be fine. Well, no, you've been around a few years.
Yeah, I've managed to wing it for 35 years, so I'm not doing too bad. I don't think I've ever really not done anything or done something and told them, because I personally think they need to know, you know, because if you did something like that and they crashed for whatever reason, you'd just feel so bad about yourself, wouldn't you? So I always try and keep them on the same page that I'm on.
Yeah, there's no right or wrong answer to it. Yeah. It's just an interesting thought.
Yeah, because it
depends on
really.
Yeah, it depends on the rider and how well you know him and or her.
Yeah,
depending
exactly.
on where you're working these days, especially in the FHO team. There's been
we've had some girls in the team.
The girls in the team the last sort of 2 years. The big thing for me for 2023 for you was taking Josh back to the TT.
Yeah.
After a 5-6 year absence?
It was like 5 or 6 year absence.
Something like that, wasn't it? But it was a long time.
Yeah, and it was big for me as well, because originally when I spoke with Faye in December, January, our agreement was based on British Superbikes only. And I was told that Josh Brookes will be focusing on the Superbike Championship and not doing any road events. So I actually wasn't contracted to do the Northwest, the TT, or Macau. And when we moved into March, and then Josh says, I want to go back to the TT, and they discussed it with the team, and they decided that they're building just a stock bike for the TT, not take his Superbike, because obviously it is a handful. We see how Pete struggled for the first week and a half to get his bike dialed in. You know, and that's a team with a wealth of experience and a rider with a wealth of experience. It could have probably backfired on Josh doing that. So it was right, the decision to go with a stock bike. And then Josh asked me, am I going to do the roads? And I thought, well, I obviously two options. I could easily have said, no, I'm not contracted to do it. But I just felt it were wrong for the team and for Josh to go there without his crew chief. So I just agreed. I agreed to do it. And it was all right, actually. I hadn't been to the Isle of Man for, like, on a work level since the Cameron Donald days, which was like 2011, 12, 13, I think 14 on the Norton. And then pre that, I'd done quite a lot of the Isle of Man. I'd won TTs with McGuinness. And even going back to the early 90s, I'd assisted like Joey Dunlop, Brian Reid, and won TTs with them. So I've got a wealth of TT experience. But being away for so long, it were... the first few days were a shock, to be fair, like a real shock. Obviously, we had a stock bike that we hadn't ridden all year, so everything was complete alien to us. Although we did take it to the Northwest, but we only did the one practice session at the Northwest, and then they made us go home because on the carbon wheel scenario on the stock bike, which was that's a pod alone, that, I guess. But anyway,
I'm deliberately not going to go down that route and put you on the spot.
It was what it was. We were a little bit in the wrong. They were in the wrong. And the annoying thing is there just wasn't a compromise on the day, you know. We were running homologated wheels, and the rules say you've got to run homologated wheels. But then also there's a small print in the rules that says you can't run carbon wheels, but it refers to more superbike. This was a stock bike. Anyway, we didn't have time to fit alloy wheels because we were there, so it meant not competing in that. And it was just decision made that we just left the event and that were that. You know, it was a shame, but that were that. So I think we did five laps on Thursday on the stop bike, and which was pretty much just straight line braking for a roundabout, a couple of chicanes. So we didn't really get a wealth of experience on it. Rocked up at the Isle of Man. I think Monday was the first practice, so we got an unofficial session Monday morning and then a time session Monday evening, which was basically Josh just riding round and getting familiar with the track again because he hadn't been there. I think he did 126, 127 mile an hour at the end of the first day. He was relatively happy with everything. He did complain that he was getting a lot of impact through his arse, basically.
Okay.
And the subframe on the bike had collapsed. It needed strengthening and changing. And Josh's comments were, the bike feels really soft everywhere and I'm feeling, you know, a lot through my backside. We kind of said, it's the subframe collapsing because you could push it and feel it. So obviously he was feeling a lot more of that. Looking at data, because we ran, the great thing was we ran full data on the bike, as did Peter. So it was really good going through data with Josh and against Pete.
Yeah.
To bring him up to the speeds we did do. And looking at the data on the rear, we weren't really using a lot of average and the bike was quite hard. So for Tuesday, we went to a slightly softer setting on the rear shock. And I'll never forget that day because I literally sat in the tent while Josh is riding and some rider came up to me and I know who he is, but I can't remember his name now. And he's, you know, he's quite a biggish bloke. Does the TT because it's more of a hobby to him, you know, and he's fast, but he's not, you know, front level sort of fast. And he came up to me and he says, Josh passed me into Ballacrane, I think it were, followed him through Glen Ellen, got to Kurt Michael and a few back markers. Josh managed to get through them and pulled away. And he says, and he turned around to me and he just says, a fat bloke like me shouldn't be able to follow Josh Brookes. He says, his bike is tying itself in knots and he's hitting curb to curb to curb. He said, there's something fundamentally wrong with the bike. Josh came in at the end of the session and he literally just pulled us to one side and very calm. He basically just said, what have you done to the bike? He's trying to kill me. And he was white. And then I went white and I just thought to myself, what am I doing at the Isle of Man? I just thought, what am I doing here? You know, I spent 10 years in Grand Prix and stuff and all of a sudden you're thrown back in the Isle of Man. And it's just a matter of changing your mindset to do it and stuff. So we had a good look at the bike and we found a problem with the bike. The potentiometers that were on it were not calibrated correct. So we were getting false data. So then for Wednesday, we went a completely different direction. And then from that point onwards, we just got the bike better, better, better to where we were. But that Tuesday night, I didn't know whether to go home, jump off the pier. Just honestly, it was awful. I didn't know what to do. And I thought, I can't go and leave Josh. And to be fair, the rest of the team, everyone clubbed together. With the experience of all Pete's crew and everything and we resolved any issues we did have over the 2 weeks and the final results were really good for both riders and FHO. And Josh did his personal best in the end, which was good. I think he was just shy of, I can't remember what he did now, 133 mile an hour or something, which was fast. And we know how he can go faster with changes going back this year. It was really, I think it was the TT that impressed me most with him, because also up until the Isle of Man, we'd only had 3 weekends together. So we'd had Silverstone, Alton and Donington. So I'd literally spent 4 days with him. So a matter of probably 12 to 16 days with him, plus a little bit of testing. So I probably only knew the guy in total for 2 weeks. And then all of a sudden we was intensively practically living with each other for 2 weeks. So you get to see them, you get to see the funny side of them and you just get to know all the team members more and the riders more because it's quite intense. And that was a good 2 weeks. I think that bonded us all as a team. And it were really good. And I think that impressed me most with him, the fact that he hadn't been there for 5 or 6 years and then he just rocked up and did what he did. I was more impressed with him for what he did there than what he actually did at Silverstone, you know. So it was good. TT ended up good. So
I remember watching it on the coverage, because I watched every out. We didn't go across this year, as you know. But I remember watching it on the coverage, and you could see that first right as you go under the footbridge of the bungalow. They had a camera up there, and it catches them coming up from the bungalow under over the tram tracks. And then there's a right-hander after, and you could just, the first part, and it was one, two, three, just trying to find his tipping in point. And he looked real tentative through there. But then, so like three or four practice sessions on, the next time he's like, he's on his marker and he's through it and he's away. And it's how he developed over that first, once you, the machine issues were, knowing now what we know about the machine issues, you can understand why he was kind of struggling to do what he did.
And we definitely got the bike better. And there's still some things looking back now that could have been even better, you know. Like Pete, for example, ran Dunlop tyres, and Josh chose to use Pirelli tyres. And he only chose Pirelli because it's what he's been used to week in, week out. So he didn't want to throw another oddball into the situation. There's nothing wrong with each tyre, but one particular tyre brand, the Dunlop, is more of a stiffer carcass tyre than the Pirelli. And what we were finding over some bumps, we were getting quite a bit of deflation on the tyre and stuff, which was causing us more issues than what Pete was having, you know. So we know that going back, if we did change a combination, we can improve stuff. And the good thing having Pete and his data was Josh got up to speed fast with the course, like left, right, nowhere to brake and all that. But the hardest part is the bumps on the course. And that's what we was trying to fix. It's not knowing that there's a, like a fourth gear left-hander coming up or anything. It's the bumps entering and the bumps exiting. And it was speaking with Pete that, you know, where Josh will say going into Kurt Michael and he'd be attacking on the brakes on the bumps. So the front of the bike would be packing down, and then you're struggling to make your apex. Pete would be more brake a bit earlier. When you get to then bumping, throttle over it and then get back on the brakes. And it's knowing what to do on the bumps and little things like on the exit, there's a series of bumps, and Pete would be like, you've got to get on the throttle sooner and pick the front wheel up and wheelie over the bumps to get through it. Otherwise, it's just going to sit down and start wallowing. And so it was Josh speaking with Pete and explaining just how to go through the bumps. Not so much, oh, you've got a brake here and, you know, back two gears there. It's how to actually ride the course. And that was the most interesting thing, because a lot of people probably go there and they're like, oh, I'm still learning and that. But it's not learning the course, it's learning the bumps on the course and how the bike reacts and how to approach it better. And someone like Pete's got so much experience. When we sat and went through some data, and it's actually FHO have put a like a three-part behind the scenes at the TT, and I think two parts have gone out and the third one's due to go out soon. And on that third one, there's a scenario where we looked at the data, and it was after Hilbury. There's a left-hander there, and it's quite a fast left, so I think you go through Hilbury in fifth gear, and then Josh would be just going back to fourth and kind of driving through, and Pete were going from fifth to sixth and just going full throttle through there and carrying nearly 30 k's more than Josh. And we understood
after Hilbury,
so it goes through Hilbury and then the left, so that left there, we couldn't understand why Pete was going up a gear. And at this point, Lee, who's our sort of PR sort of cameraman, he was filming it, and Pete turned around to Josh and says, no, I always go to six there, it's not a mistake. And Josh is like, yeah, but you're trying to scrub speed off. Why are you going at six? He just says, I just get bored of bike control. He says, rather than go back one, put it in sixth gear, point for the wall on the inside and go full throttle, and the bike will just drift all the way around the wall and you can carry your speed. And you could literally see Josh's face go like that. And he says, there's no way am I pointing my bike at a wall, going up a gear and going full throttle. I'm not ready for that yet. And it's just all experience, confidence. Pete's just got, I mean, what, 136 and a half mile an hour he did on a stop bike. Unbelievable. When you watch the onboard, you can actually see that there's improvement still, and he looks really safe doing it as well. So just, the experience, the knowledge he's got, there was definitely an asset for Josh, you know. As teammates, they work really well together, to be fair.
That's very open.
Yeah, it was, to be honest. Even going to the Isle of Man, Pete didn't keep anything away from Josh. He was more than happy just to go through everything with him, you know. And I think that that helped Josh get to speed, you know, a lot quicker. And yeah, the lap time he did on a stock bike, I think it's something like the fourth ever fastest lap on a stocker. And, you know, he's incredible, really, considering he's been away for so long. So yeah, it was good. And then obviously from there, the next road event was Macau, and that was just more of just because it's FHO hometown, really. And she'd already agreed with Peter and Michael. And then one day in hospitality, Josh just went, where's my invite? And she went, well, you can ride if you want. And he's like, yeah, I'll have a go. And so Josh ended up doing it.
That's a whole different proposition.
Yeah, it was, that was an interesting trip, that. I know Josh didn't enjoy it. He actually said afterwards, I don't really want to do this again. It weren't so much scary, but it weren't great because he had no markers of where we were going, because it all just looks the same. It's just yellow and black, sort of walled all the way around. We actually ran Dunlop tyres in Macau.
Okay.
And the bike setup completely changed. So you only get two practice sessions. We were on a new tyre, and going with the bike just didn't work. Mm. So we had to constantly change it. In one of the sessions, we had a mechanical gearbox issue, so we missed most of the session. So literally we had a practice session straight into qualifying. I think that put him 13th, and he were about 6 seconds off Pete's pace. And at that point we were like, look, race is tomorrow, just ride around, go back to Australia, have a bit of an holiday. But not Josh Brookes.
Nah, it's great, not in start, his nature, is it?
Battling for the podium, ended up finishing fourth in the end. He took 5.5 seconds off his lap time, and I think the lap he ended up doing in the end was like only about a second shy off the fastest lap or something. So he just plugged away. Incredible, really. And then he obviously got off the bike, and we were like, well done. And he was just like, never doing that again. And he's just like, well, why did you do it? You know, you could have just rode around, yeah, going home. And he's like, yeah, but I'm a racer when I put my helmet on. That's what I do. And that, again, that was another impressive thing from him, because he didn't need to do that. Did not need to put his neck out in Macau.
That's the consummate professional thing again.
No need to do it. And he wanted that podium. And the last two laps, he were putting fastest lapping, you know, and he finished about a second off the podium, and he were trying to get it. And, you know, when you try, the consequences doesn't even outweigh it, does it?
No.
But he wanted it that bad. And I was just like, wow, fair play. So that was our road journey for the year.
Had you done Macau before?
Yeah, years ago. So last time I were there was 2003. So I did it in 2002 and 2003 with Rutter, when we were on the Renegade Ducati. So we'd won it then. And then before that with McGuinness a couple of years, and Ramsey. So 98, 99, 2000. I'd done it quite a bit, but it changed so much.
That was my next question. How much has it changed?
Ridiculous. They've completely built what was Wasteland is now the new Macau, and they've got all these, you know, new hotels similar to what they have in Vegas, and it's all completely different, and it's just growing all the time. I think we were there for about 9 or 10 days, which for me was too much, really. It was more of an extended vacation than a work trip, if you know what I mean. I'm used to doing what I was doing in the World Championship, where you'd fly in on a Wednesday, get the job done, and out of there on a Sunday, stroke Monday. So there was a lot of nothing to do. And where we were staying was kind of old Macau, where the racetrack is. So I had to make a few trips over to the new part. You know, got to see some new sights and things like that. But yeah, that side of things didn't really, I was quite bored, if I'm honest. I just wanted to rock up and do the job as such. But on the same hand, it was nice to see, it was Faye's hometown. It was nice to see the casinos, and Faye took us out every night. And, you know, at the end, she threw a big party and stuff, and all, it was all worth seeing, you know. It was all an experience, but, you know, I don't think I wouldn't personally rush to get back. If I had a rider, I'd go, obviously, but it wouldn't be on my bucket list of things to do again. But it was all right.
Speaking of the GP paddock, I know you miss it. In a lot of ways, but is there a lot to be said for being at home in your own bed on a Sunday night, being back in BSB? Especially with the business
mainly,
with MJW
mainly
as well.
For this place, because if racing stops tomorrow, I don't have to go racing anymore. This is more than keeps me busy enough, you know. And that was my mindset leaving Grand Prix, and it was only that Faye gave me the opportunity. And I'm glad she did, because racing's my passion. Do you know what I mean? It's why I go racing. It's why I'm doing the British Superbikes. I want to win as much as FHO and as much as Josh, you know. So that's why I do that. This is my livelihood. This is my job. And this was being neglected while doing Grand Prix, because I've been running this since 2010. And obviously doing Grand Prix, it was difficult, because there was some times where you'd end up landing on a long haul back from Australia at 6 o'clock at Heathrow, and by 12 o'clock I'd be here building an engine to meet demands, you know, and it was getting exhausting. And then with COVID, it nearly became impossible, because the first year and a half when we was having to travel and work under COVID conditions, and one country would be red listed and another, so then the team would be like, you have to stay out in Europe for 4 weeks, you can't go back to the UK, you get isolated, and then I'm having to phone customers up and tell them I'm not back this week, and you soon lose your customers. So it was soon taking a little bit of a knocking, really, so I had to be more present here. So yes, sleeping in your own bed is definitely better, but it's mainly to grow this place, you know. So yeah, that's why I enjoy being back.
And one or two will hear him tinkering around in the background. You've got your son Brad working on the suspension side of things.
Yeah.
He's making a name for himself in the British Superbike paddock as a
He's been
mechanic and working with Tom Tapares last year at McAdam Racing.
Yeah, that's right. When he turned around to me at 16 and says, oh, I want to do something similar to you, I thought, oh, no, you don't. No, you don't. But he went to college, and I had to take him on as an apprentice and that. And you know, he strips build engines now, and we formed this suspension company, I think, a year and a half ago. He spent quite a lot of time down K-Tech getting tuition and stuff like that, and he pretty much runs that side of things now. And then off the back of that, he was Tom Tapares' mechanic last year in the Supersport team. He's going to be working with Carter Brown this year in the new Josh Motorsport team. So I can see he's got that equal passion to go away at weekends now, which for me is what it's all about. This, you've got to want it to do it, and not just become, the minute it becomes a job and you wake up on a Monday and like, oh, I've got to go to work, stop, because this isn't a job. It's, you know, it's an enjoyment. I've been, you know, it's been great that I've been paid over the years just to do a glorified hobby, you know. And this business now is a business, but I enjoy doing it. You know, I get so many different characters coming in here, and I'm mixed from 6-year-old kids to professional athletes, you know, so I get to see and do everything. So it's good. You know, I haven't really changed too much, to be fair.
And it's becoming that point of call as well, isn't it? You're still working fairly closely with Jake. With Jake Dixon?
Yeah, I do.
And a bit with Fraser Rogers?
Yeah, I do quite a few of the riders and stuff. So pretty much December's a write-off here, because December's for Jake. So Jake will land 3rd of December, says, right, I'm going to Spain testing 2nd of January, and he'll just expect all December, we've just got to work for Jake. So we ended up prepping all his pit bikes. He's got a road race bike now, a dirt track bike, so pretty much Jake was here near enough every other day in December, and throwing in new projects. Like, I've got a little 50cc quad that I've just refreshed and done all the engine, and that's for his daughter Summer, and she's one soon. And he's like, as soon as she's one, she needs to be on that quad. And it's, you know, it's just Jake. Yeah, I did suspension on like Cow Rides motocross bike, and done a bit with Fraser. And I know the likes of Danny Buchan wants to fetch stuff, and we've got some British Talent kids bike. So I try and help a lot of you road race people that use motocross for practicing. If I can support them and help them, I will do, because that's my background. So that's, if I can give something back, I always will. You know, I sponsored Fraser a little bit personally last year. I think we're going to do something again this year. And there's a few riders who, you know, Little Evans, Belford, I've always personally helped. There's quite a few riders who I personally help out, you know, whether it's my time or financially. If I can, I will. And it's just to give something back to the sport, you know. It's difficult for anyone. So if we can give something back, we do, you know. So it's good that I've got that connection from motocross to road racing, and vice versa, you know. So So yeah,
I've seen Fraser's been out quite a bit on the doing motos over the winter.
Yeah, he was out a couple of days ago on it since we've done it, and I think he's going out this week. He's on about coming up this end, maybe Fat Cats towards the end of this week and going out or something. So said if he comes up here, I'll go down the track and have an afternoon with him and see if we can.
I want to see him do well this year, you know.
Yeah, I think he will do well.
He's got the talent. It's never been in question.
Yeah, I don't know anything about Fraser, to be fair. I only met Fraser through his mum and the family because I help out Luca on the motor too. So I do his engines and stuff. So I agreed with Sarah, Fraser's mum, at the end of like 12 months ago that if I'm in the paddock, I will, if there's any support I can give her, I will do. And then off the back of that, she introduced, when Fraser came back to ride for the Ian Newton team, we worked an agreement out between us all to get him on that bike, you know, financially or whatever way we could. And I got to meet Fraser then, and actually looking back at his CV and stuff, he was fast, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Just one of them where some doors open for some and not for others. And unfortunately for him, the doors probably didn't open. Otherwise, he could have easily have been in the Moto 3, Moto 2 paddock and had a career out
completely.
Of it because he were fast enough, you know. It was great what he did on that Aprilia after being off a bike for 2 years and literally sticking it on the front row and challenging for a podium. And I think the Superbike will suit him really well. I know the tag team he's with is a really good team. They've definitely got budget. The Honda bike will be a good bike. And I Fraser's going to be a strong top 10 man this year.
I'd like to see that.
He's going to be knocking on our heels at a few rounds, which is a bit worrying. But I don't mind, you know. I want him to do well. You know, he's a very nice lad. He's just had a daughter and that, you know. He's got a family growing, and the whole family's great, you know. So I hope he does do well.
I think that's calmed him down a bit.
That'd be good.
It's calmed him down a bit, having the family as well, having a stable relationship.
Yeah, probably. Like I say, I don't know what he was like before. I literally met him in October last year. That were it.
Known him a long time. He's a good guy.
You don't mind helping good people out, do you? You know, if someone is a genuine good person, then I feel necessary. If you can help them, help them, because why not? It doesn't matter, does it? No, it doesn't. It's if you can, you can. So
I think even he'll admit he lost his way a little bit, and now he's got his focus back, and I really want to see him do well.
Yeah, I think he will.
And the same with Jake. You know Jake better than most people I know. What's Jake's career path now? What do you see? Will he make it to MotoGP? Will that be, or is he going to remain Moto2? Because his age is sort of edging against him a little bit as well.
Yeah, it's difficult.
Because he's late 20s now. He's nearly 30, isn't he?
In the last couple of years, you know, he has had some great offers to go to the World Superbike paddock. You know, he got offered the factory Hondas. He got offered Top Rack's Yamaha ride. And what's good about Jake is you can switch to that paddock and literally double your salary. And it's not about that for Jake. He wants to win a world championship, so he's staying put where he is. I think every year he's got the potential to win it. It's just, you're always going to get that one or two Spaniard or Italian that's coming through that's young and hungry that's probably going to beat him. But he's a top three man. And I think if he does win a championship or is near, he could still get a MotoGP ride. But I think the chances of that are getting less and less, purely because on the young talent that's coming through, their passports, some of them carry money. English riders don't carry money.
No.
So it's difficult. So I think someone like Jake could easily have a 2-3-4 year career still in Moto2, earning decent money, but enjoying himself more than anything.
That's the important thing.
And as a fallback plan, he can always go World Superbikes. And as a bigger fallback plan, he can always come back to England, you know. So he doesn't have to rush and do anything. He's really happy in the team where he is. He's happy in that environment. And a happy Jake's a fast Jake. So if he starts the season happy and confident, you know, he'll be on the podium every other week. And then, you know, mid-season he can look at whether he can fight for a championship. I believe he can. And he definitely believes he can. It's just sometimes everything's just got to go your way, you know. And you know, sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. You know, he found a little bit of form mid-season this year, and then he had the run-in at Silverstone. Not really his fault, but stuff like that happens, you know, and you know, and he's learned from that. You know, he probably was a little bit outspoken on the day, and he knows that, and he takes everything on board, and he matures and takes a step forward. So he's still growing as a rider. You know, he might be 28, but he's still got so much more to give. You know, so, and I think now he's got a daughter as well. He's been up here for the day with Summer, and she's been darting around here and a little kiddie car thing. And I just think to myself, how's Sarah let you out of the house with a girl, you know? But, you know, as a father, he's great, yeah. You know? So that's matured him a lot. So he takes all this into this season, then Jake's going to win more races. 100% he will. So, yeah, it'll be good.
What does 2024 hold for you? How do you improve on 23?
Yeah. Well, we can certainly improve. I don't even know where we finished in the championship. It was 6th or 7th for it. I'm not sure. And I know that going into Brands Hatch, we were still in shout for winning the championship. So it was nice to be there. Obviously, after the start, it was disappointing the season went how it were. But everybody got up to speed. Everyone were, you know, testing and going forward. And we just remained where we were, really. And it was no fault of anybody. It was, you know, we were lacking a little bit of structure and parts from BMW. And, you know, we had a few little issues ourselves, but for sure we can improve this year. Whether we can be a contender, difficult with the new tyres and some of the rules and stuff, we shall see. But I've got every confidence in the FHO crew and Josh. So, I don't see why we can't still finish where we left last year, you know. The plan always is now is to go and try and win the championship, you know. Whether we can, let's see. I believe we can if everything works right on the day. But, you know, you need quite a bit of luck in, as well, you know, to go on your side. It doesn't matter how much work and effort people put in the team. You still need a little bit of luck, you know. So, could be our year, might not be. Who knows? Let's see. But we're gonna attack the season.
That continuity is important,
and that we're gonna win it. So let's see. Yeah.
Two things. Well, just gonna grab my phone a second because we have our patrons, our fine patrons that help us out every month.
Yeah.
And they get to ask questions.
Okay.
So I put this out yesterday. And if we have a look at this one, there we are.
This is the part we haven't rehearsed.
This is the bit we haven't rehearsed, mate. This is straight off the bat. Yeah. And I had a look at this yesterday from Mick Strickland. Mick, thank you very much. He says, you've been around the racing paddock for quite a while as crew chief for some amazing riders and in many different domestic and international series. Who's the best rider you've worked with? And which is the best series you've worked in?
That
is a, there you go. I'll leave that with you.
Wow. Yeah.
Thanks, Mick.
To be fair, everywhere I've worked has been great. I haven't really worked in a championship or with a rider where I've thought to myself, that was hellish that year. Obviously, last year was great with Josh and British. The run-up of the World Championship to that, working with various riders like McPhee, Sasaki, Kornfell, Zarco, Herrin, all people like that, was good. Before that, in the British Superbikes with the PBM team, and I also got to spend a year with Norrie Haga. That was an interesting year. Very, very, probably one of the most interesting riders. Just so much talent. And just unbelievable. I remember once a story at Alton Park, and he went out in free practice one at Alton Park, and we were on the Swan Yamaha, and he was dead last. And I mean dead last. And this is no disrespect to women or anything, but Jenny Timmoth were racing then, and she out sort of qualified him, which she's fast, you know.
Yeah.
But Norrie shouldn't be behind somebody. And
no.
He came and sat next to me, and I opened my clipboard, and I'm like, right, Norrie, what's the problem? And he just got my clipboard and shut it. And he says, there's no problem. And I says, well, what's up? He just, and his words were, he says, Norrie's not been paid. So there was a bit of cash flow issues going on at the time, and no, he hadn't been paid. And it was nothing serious. It was just a thing. So I'd spoke to the team manager and I said, what was wrong? And I said, no, basically, Norris says he hadn't been paid, and that's his result. Within an hour or something, there was transactions made. Norris got paid. And FP2, Norris went out and just put it P1. That were it. Came back, sat down, shut the folder again. He said, everything's good, Mark. And that were Noriaga. So that was good. Working with the likes of Eugene Laverty were good. I had a good few years in World Supersport with him. I think ultimately the best person I've ever worked with and got closer was obviously Craig Jones, because not only was he a great rider off the bike, he was a great character, and he was my best mate, you know. So, unfortunately. But, yeah, Craig was by far the best character I've ever worked with. And I don't think anyone can fill his shoes. But
no.
You know. But yeah, they say they've all been interesting in their own ways, you know. So yeah, it's been definitely interesting.
Superb. And he put a little bonus question on the end. He says, how does BSB stack up to the series that you did? Like Jeep. Oi, keep the noise down.
As it stack up to what?
Yeah, his final part was, how does BSB measure up to your favourite series if it's not BSB?
Yeah, I think obviously the MotoGP paddock's the best one, yeah. Purely because on the professionalism and they've got a lot more money than other paddocks. So you get looked after better, your hospitality is bigger, you know what I mean? It's just that whole environment is...
The pinnacle of motorcycle racing, isn't it, for a reason?
Exactly. The people are good. There's nothing wrong with BSB. It's a great show. They get, 30 to 50,000 fans every weekend, which is probably more than what the MotoGP does at Silverstone. The only thing I found starting in BSB was... It's just so intense. So British Superbikes don't go out till Friday afternoon, and then they have two sessions on Friday. So by the time you finish your first session Friday, you've debriefed, which takes quite a while with Josh. Then you need to look at the data. You all of a sudden look up at the clock and you're like, oh my God, we're out in 35 minutes. So you don't have any time to react and do something. And then all of a sudden Friday's over with, you're straight into qualifying, you've got a race, and then another two races, and it's just so intense. And you can't work to your maximum capacity because you don't have time to look and study, where in, say, World Superbikes or GPs, you go out Friday morning and you go out Friday afternoon, the same time every week, and you know you've got that 4 or 5 hour window between sessions, yeah, to look at data, work hard and get the best. And I find I can't do that in BSB because it's just so... So that side I struggled with a little bit. Got used to it.
Did you have to adjust to that? Because I guess from round one to round 11, your Fridays changed dramatically you got used to how the timings work.
Yeah, I don't think I ever did adjust to it. It was just it was just from Friday. Friday you're just hanging around all day in the garage in the morning. And then all of a sudden you go out at like 1 o'clock or something, and then you don't stop because your next session then is like 4:30, and then it's dinner, then it's this, then it's that, and all of a sudden it's the end of the night and you're out 9 o'clock the next morning. So it was intense. I still don't get why they do it, really. I don't get why. I do get, because it was apparently to do with cost saving. So some of the part-time people don't turn up on a Thursday. They can turn up Friday morning, prep the wheels and do what they do on a Friday morning, and then everything goes Friday afternoon.
But most teams are still there Thursday night.
Exactly. And for cost saving, it probably isn't a great thing. And all it does, it just makes it so much more hard work for the teams. Personally, I think they should just set the superbikes at Friday morning, Friday afternoon, Saturday morning, Saturday afternoon. Keep it the same and work everything around it. Yeah. But obviously, they've got the ways of doing it, and I've had to adapt to that, and I still don't think I've adapted to it. I still go home on a Sunday like, where did my weekend go? We've had three races this weekend. I'm used to one race a weekend.
And here we are.
And I'm a nervous chap as it is as well. One thing I have done this year is learn to stay calm. I think for the first three or four rounds, prior to pit lane opening, I'd be pacing up and then I'd be getting Josh nervous. He'd be like looking at me like, sit down, you're getting me nervous. And then now I'm just like, that is what it is, you know, let's just get on with it.
Okay, last two questions. Yep. I'm going to do the last question again for those that haven't caught the audio shows previously with Mark. But what we're asking every guest before the season starts, who's going to win MotoGP, World Superbike and BSB in 24?
MotoGP, I'd like to say Bagnaia, but I think Marc Márquez. He's special, really is. And obviously working in the same paddock over the past few years, I know his crew chief really well, and I've seen some very special things, what he's done on a bike that most people can't do. And I think on a bike now that works, I'd like to think he's just going to check out every weekend. But it is still a bit unknown with his past injuries and stuff. I think he is going to check out. Well, it's going to be between him and Bagnaia, I think. And I think Mark's going to do it. World Superbikes. And I said this last year, and I'm going to stand by it, but Baliga is going to win it. And I said, when he signed for Ducati, because we were brought up with him in Moto3 and Moto2, and he is a world-class rider. He was picked as the VR46 Academy when he was younger. There was some complications and he fell out with the academy and ended up then doing his own thing and ended up going to World Supersport. But his father was a good racer in his time. His pedigree's there, and you've seen what he's done in testing so far. I think he's just going to check out. They all thought Bautista was going to be a pain last year, but Baliga's just going to, he's going to be, he's won it, I think. Top Rack will do all right, but I don't think he's a contender. So, yeah, Baliga. What was the other one?
BSB.
Yeah. I've got to say Josh Brookes, I know, but...
So, if it wasn't Josh, who would it be?
Josh is more than capable.
No question.
It's just whether we can give him a package. And that's a little bit of a worry for me, to be fair. And not that we can't give him a package, it's what we get from Germany, you know. Glenn's going to be fast, but with the rule changes, I'm not sure whether the Ducati's going to be as... Last year, that bike was so good. I mean, what Tommy Bridewell did at Donington, coming from last to first in about three laps, he just took the mickey out of people. He was just outbraking them, opening the throttle, passing them. And that weren't necessarily just the bike, but Tommy had gelled with it so much. He was unbelievable. And that last race at Brands Hatch, I mean, normally when Josh is riding, I have on my spec sheet, like, time to the front, who's posting the fastest lap, yeah. Josh's fastest lap, time behind him, position, write down a lot of information. I actually don't watch anything. I'm too busy looking at the timing screen, writing it all down, because it goes into spec sheets and graphs and statistics, and you can see how your weekend's developed. The last six laps at Brands Hatch, I just went... I'm not writing anything. I'm watching this. That was intense, that, wasn't it? I think the Honda's going to be good this year because on the rules. So you've got to think Tommy's still going to be favourable. Can't rule Glenn out. And you can't rule Kyle Ride out on that Yamaha because it's the same bike. They've got, you know, Ryan Vickers. Yeah, BSB's probably the hardest to call.
I agree.
There's seven, eight riders. Danny Kent, yeah. 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 If I had to put a bet on now, I'd actually probably bet on Danny Kent because I'd get great odds on him.
Yeah.
Because I think he can win it. Even O'Halloran on that Kawasaki is going to be good. It's Danny Buchan on a Kawasaki. He will win races. Guaranteed. If the Cadwell, Thruxton, Knockhill.
Yeah.
Danny Buchan's going to win. I don't know. I'd like to say Glenn, but that's probably too easy. So I'd like to say Josh, but so I think Tommy can defend his title.
Interesting. Okay. I mean, there are some rule changes, aren't there? Is the X done now that the X isn't being used?
Yeah, the X isn't being used anymore now. It was up until about 2 weeks ago, and it got published that it was still being used. And then there was quite an uproar from some teams to say that they'd done all their pre-season testing on a zero. So why are we using an X? And then a document went out that I think every team owner or manager had to tick a box to say which tyre. And I think the majority... Okay. Is zero, so it's going to be zero, which it doesn't really bother us too much because whether we're on an X, we're 2 or 3 tenths off the front, yeah. And when we're on a zero, we're 2 or 3 tenths off. the same, you know. So we struggle with grip. It's definitely not going to help us, but we're the same as everyone else. Yeah. So we just got to make it work, you know. So whatever tire it is doesn't really faze us, to be fair. So I think I'm going to say Tommy. Don't know why, but like you say, it can be anyone, can't it? Danny,
I think so.
Jason, Glenn,
Josh. Think it's one of the most open ones for years.
Even Hickey can win races, you know? There's so many, but yeah, I think Tommy. I'm going to say Tommy.
And finally, your best hire car story.
Yeah, I think I did this last time.
You did, but what's
the thing we did last time?
A lot of new viewers
and
listeners since then.
I remembered another one. We were in... It was 2008. We were in Grand Prix with Ilmor, and I was with the I was in the hire car with some of the Suter technicians. So there was Alex from Suter and a mechanic called Uwe, a really good bloke. And I remember we was coming back to Sama Hotel, which is at KL Airport. And I remember it was on the motorway, and it was quite a fast left-hander. And as we went round the left-hander, he lost control. And he literally just skimmed the barrier all the way around the corner. And then we were facing the wrong way around. And at that point, it was like, wow, we're all right. We've survived. And then looking out the window, there was a bus coming straight towards us. And we were facing the motorway. The road, and he quickly just put it in gear and just spun it round. And how we, yeah. That was scary, that. But that was just being a clown, you know,
yeah.
Pulling handbrakes on and just, we've never rolled. I've never been in one that's been rolled or totaled. We've done some small damage to them. But I'm quite sensible, really. I kind of respect it's not mine and look after it sort of thing. I know people have that mentality when they get in a hire car to just destroy it. You can't really do that so much now, can you?
No.
Back 10 years ago or something, you'd pay a small insurance thing and you could literally take it back, smashed to bits. You get one scratch on a hire car now and they're just
fine. Oh, they're videoing stuff, photographing stuff.
It's a bit more difficult now with hire cars, but yeah, I've definitely been in a few that have nearly been on the roof. So yeah.
Brilliant. Ladies and gentlemen, well, I hope you've enjoyed that as much as I have. Make sure you check in the description for the Patreon. Also, what else have we got? There's the Patreon site. Like and subscribe. Make sure you ding the bell. That's more important because we can get more and more coverage from YouTube. So like, subscribe, ding the bell, drop on the Patreon. Mark, thank you very much indeed, mate.
No, thank you.
All the best for the season.
Yeah, yeah. Cheers.
Pleasure to see you again. And we'll do this again later in the year.
Brilliant.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mark Woodage.
Thank you.